This is the first in a series of videos about DNA replication. I'm going to review the basic process of replication, but I'm not going into a lot of depth about the different proteins and their function. Replication is a complicated process, and we could get lost in a lot of detail about the functions of the different proteins involved. But I think a better use of our time and energy is to make sure you understand the basic process, including how supercoiling is dealt with, and then to go into the mechanisms by which initiation of replication occurs and how initiation is regulated. If you understand these processes, you should be able to predict what will happen if certain proteins are knocked out or overexpressed, and the interactive class session and assignment will give you practice interpreting experimental data related to replication. So in this video, I'll give an overview of the process of DNA replication. Replication begins at replication origins, locations at which the two strands of DNA are pulled apart to form a replication bubble. At first, one copy of helicase exists at each replication fork. Because DNA polymerase can't synthesize a new strand given only a template, a primase enzyme synthesizes a short RNA primer on each template strand. The primer provides a 3' end to which the replicative DNA polymerase can add nucleotides. Before DNA polymerase can bind, a sliding clamp protein is added to the template primer complex. The sliding clamp encircles the template and the primer. Then DNA polymerase is bound to the sliding clamp and it begins synthesis. Meanwhile, the two helicases unwind the double-stranded DNA, expanding the size of the replication bubble. DNA polymerase synthesizes DNA in the 5' to 3' direction. That means that at each replication fork, the polymerase on one template strand moves in the same direction as the helicase. Synthesis of this strand, the leading strand, can be done continuously in one long piece. But the polymerase on the other template strand moves in the direction opposite to the way the helicase moves. Therefore, synthesis of this strand, the lagging strand, must be done in short pieces, with a new primer required each time synthesis must begin again. The short pieces of DNA on the lagging strand are called Okazaki fragments after their discoverer. Eventually, the primers on the lagging strand are removed, the pieces are joined together, and two copies of the original DNA strand are produced. These diagrams show a more complete representation of the proteins at an E. coli replication fork. The helicase is thought to be the basis for a large complex of proteins called the replisome. The replisome includes the clamp loader complex, which is not shown on the left diagram, but is represented by this cluster of subunits in the middle on the right. The clamp loader is responsible for adding the sliding clamp to DNA. The replisome also contains at least two DNA polymerases with their sliding clamps, three primases, and one or more topoisomerases, the function of which I'll talk about in the next video. Single-strand binding proteins are also necessary to prevent single-stranded DNA from forming base-paired secondary structures. In the classic model of the replisome, two DNA polymerases are present at the replisome, both permanently associated with the helicase. The lagging strand template loops around to allow the 5' to 3' synthesis. When the lagging strand polymerase finishes one Okazaki fragment, it releases the template and binds to the next primer. More recent studies indicate that three DNA polymerases are often present in the replisome. The third polymerase is likely waiting to begin replication of the next Okazaki fragment, or it might even start synthesis before the previous Okazaki fragment is finished. In this table, I'm showing the major functionalities that are present at the replication fork, along with the names of the proteins in E. coli and in eukaryotes. You're not responsible for knowing the names in the different systems, but this table might help you interpret some diagrams in this series of videos. A lot of work is currently going on to better understand the dynamics of DNA synthesis at the replisome. This work has generated evidence that goes against the classic picture of DNA replication. I already mentioned the idea that some substantial proportion of the time, three DNA polymerases are bound at the replisome, not just two. Studies in phage T7 replication suggest that for most Okazaki fragments, the lagging strand DNA polymerase actually dissociates from the replisome and carries out synthesis behind the replication fork, as shown here. Sometimes the lagging strand polymerase remains associated with the replisome, forming the classic trombone loop structure, but this seems to be less common than dissociation. Also, in E. coli, there's evidence that the leading strand polymerase stalls or pauses periodically during synthesis while helicase keeps unwinding DNA. This generates a so-called leading strand loop between the helicase and the leading strand polymerase, which is coated with single-strand binding proteins. In addition, some evidence indicates that the leading strand polymerase sometimes dissociates from the replisome entirely, requiring recruitment of another polymerase to continue synthesis on the leading strand. I mention these studies to make the point that replication is not always the orderly process it is often represented to be. As usual, reality is messier than the tidy pictures or models we create for ourselves. These diagrams summarize the process of Okazaki fragment maturation in E. coli and in eukaryotes. In E. coli, the replicative DNA polymerase, polymerase 3, dissociates from the template when it reaches an RNA primer. DNA polymerase 1, which is also used in DNA repair, replaces pol 3 at the replisome. Pol 1 has a 5' to 3' exonuclease activity, which it uses to digest the primer while synthesizing DNA to replace the primer. Eventually, the polymerase dissociates, leaving behind double-stranded DNA with a nick in the newly synthesized strand. And this nick is sealed by DNA ligase. In eukaryotes, the replicative DNA polymerase, polymerase delta, continues synthesis when it reaches a primer. It pushes the primer out of the way, generating a single-stranded flap. At some point, the polymerase stops synthesis, and a flap endonuclease cleaves off the extra nucleic acid. DNA ligase then joins the two strands together. For this course, I won't expect you to know details of DNA replication beyond what I covered in this video, except, of course, for topics I cover in more depth in the remaining videos. So in the next video, I'll talk about the supercoiling that is generated as helicase unwinds double-stranded DNA.